So, after 2 days, I will not make an introduction. I go directly to the topic. So, a brief historical corner, but now everybody knows that. There are two EPR signals in the S2 state. Both EPR signals are seen in relative proportion depending on the condition. Gary talked about that this morning. One signal is a multi-line signal, which spread over 2,000 ghosts approximately, and he has many lines, and it arises from originate from a spin 1/2. And the second one is centroid at G4.1, and that was discovered in around the 1984. So much later, the spin value of the G4 signal was definitely attributed to 5/2, because there was a lot of discussion during 15 years approximately. And then, what is it that? Somebody call us. Okay, and finally, what I want to say immediately is that sometimes you see in literature papers before 1995 that the G4 could be intermediate state between S1 and S2. In fact, no, this is not a precursor of the multiline signal. So I remove this idea now. So the work of Mülheim have shown that probably, very probably, the two EPR signal in S2 originate from two different configurations of S2 that you know very well. It's one is the closed Cuban, which is the high spin state, and the open Cuban, which is the low spin one. So you saw also this morning in the talk of Dave Britt the S3 signal. So this signal was discovered in 1990 something by Kawamori, but this was in BBY. So in plant PS2, they were able only to see this resonance, which is the most important resonance of the spectrum. But with PS2 from cyanobacteria, it's, the quality of the spectra are much better. So it is possible not to resolve all the lines. So, okay, nevertheless that, all the lines here are difficult to see. We need to accumulate to have a very stable baseline, so it's not so easy to see. So today I will focus on this line here. And more recently, the group of Mülheim also attributed to this state by making manganese 55 under frequencies at Q-band, W-band to a system in which you have four manganese 4 in octahedral geometry for all, and the coupling of the manganese is described here to have a resultant of spin 3 that was predicted also from the X-band EPR spectrum. So, there are, since 10 years, there are huge amount of papers in which you have a result of a theoretical approach. And the number of papers in which you have an experimental approach is decreased because it's more and more difficult to have some information. So, so this is what we people like me try to do. And in particular, what could be the input of biologists like me in the study of the S2 to S3 transition? If you take the results again from Mülheim or from the group, Italian group of Guidoni and Narzi, they show that to go from S2 to S3, you need to pass through the high spin configuration of S2. They explain that in the paper of Retegan. For example, they said that when you oxidize YZ, when we oxidize YZ, you change a vector inside a dipole, inside the cluster, and you push the proton of the proton of W1 to the aspartate 61, and you favor the formation of the high spin configuration, and only the high spin configuration can be oxidized to reach S3. This is the same here by another technique, molecular dynamic. Finally, the other conclude to the same result that the S2 high spin state is an obligate state for going to S3. In the work of Ville-Kaila, they said it's probably a favor intermediate step. And okay, I will not describe that. If you want more questions, you ask to Ville. But okay, the point here is that when you form S2, normally, normal condition, you see the low spin configuration. But only the high spin configuration can go to S3. So what could happen? So the idea is that the oxidation of YZ induce an electrostatically event which result in a deprotonation of something to tip the curium to S2 high spin form can be modeled by changing the pH of the solution. And this is what we did. And we did an experiment in which we incubate the PS2 at a different pH value. And then we make a 200K illumination, a condition in which you can make S2. And we did that for all the pH value. And this is what is reported. And we did that for PS2 with calcium or PS2 with strontium. So this is, we don't see very well, but this is what we did here. That is a light minus dark EPR spectra. It's S2 minus S1 at different pH value. That is in PS2 with calcium. So when I say with calcium, it's calcium inside the cluster. And from pH 7.5 to 9, you see, you will see after why you see this value here. The spectra are totally identical, whatever the pH value, both in shape and in amplitude for the multiline signal, which is the spin 1/2 state of the cluster. So I don't describe the other signal here. You have indication if you can read it what it is. So with strontium, the same result from pH 5.5 to 8.6, you have no change in the amplitude of the signal, and the shape is also the same whatever the pH. You can see here that the multiline is different with strontium when you compare with calcium. That is well known since long time. So we see we have no effect of pH here, but now if after making the 200K illumination, you warm the system briefly at room temperature. We don't need room temperature, but I'll explain later. We can go 230K is enough. But okay, here this is room temperature, briefly in the dark, 1 second. You freeze again, and you record again the EPR. And now you plot the spectrum recorded here minus this one. This is shown here. And what you see is when you increase the pH, the multiline signal decreases and the G4 signal increases. Means that the proportion of low spin state decreases when you increase the pH. And when you increase the pH, the proportion, of course, of the high spin configuration increases. So you have a conversion of the low spin to high spin state when you increase the pH. And this is the same for calcium and for strontium. Now, if you plot the amplitude of the high spin versus the pH for the two samples, for the strontium sample in red here, you have some curve which looks normal for a pH titration. The fit here is a system where I use a very basic equation here for the simulation of the pH dependence. And what you can see is that with calcium, now it's, the transition is a very, in less than one pH unit, you have all the transition from low spin to high spin. So also means that the number of protons, nevertheless the fact that probably this simple model is not true, but it's difficult to have to involve a model much more complicated because you have not a lot of points, and it's difficult to have more points here when in 0.5 unit you go from 0% to 100%. So, but you see immediately that the number of protons is absolutely different between calcium PS2 and strontium PS2, with a pK also which is different. So the group of Villet tried to understand what happens when we do the calcium-strontium exchange. There are several papers in literature which already report such kind of study, and the results are a bit different from those we obtain here, in the sense that here what we see is that the calcium-strontium exchange has a long distance effect. Not only, of course, around calcium you have a strong effect, that here this is an electron density which is shown in when it is red, you have increase in electron density. When it is blue, you have a decrease in electron density. And you can see that we have a change at long distance. Also, Villet have calculated what happens for the pK. And importantly, he saw some decrease for pK values for W2, W1, instead of 332 and W3, and also an increase in the pK for aspartate C1. It's in 57 on W4. And what is important for me is that when you have a decrease in a pK of W1 and increase in the pK of aspartate 61, you favor the hydrogen bonding because aspartate 61 wants to take the proton from W1. And if you do that, normally from what we do in the literature, you favor the high spin configuration. So this is why with strontium, The tendency is to have more high spin configuration than in calcium sample, already at low pH. So the next step. So okay, now we show that we can trigger in the dark the conversion from low spin to high spin, and in the cluster just by increasing the pH. And the next step is to see what happens now when we want to go to S3, because in the introduction I said that from the literature only the high spin configuration can progress to S3. And for that, after the warming here of the sample, which allow us to detect the high spin configuration at high pH, for each pH value, you can make a second illumination at low temperature, and we record the signal, and we make again the difference, means after minus before this second illumination. This is shown here only for the calcium sample, but the result is the same for strontium sample. What you can see is that the G4 disappear at when you illuminate at 200K, and now the S3 signal appears. So means that the S2 high spin configuration is able to go at 198K to S3. So to comment something that Gary said this morning, that S1, S2 is the only transition which can go, which work at low temperature. In fact, no, S2 high spin, S3 is working also at very low temperature. And what is not working at low temperature is the S2 low spin to S2 high spin, because you need to deprotonate, and that does not work. And this transition work also at 180K, so we can go very low temperature. So other thing in the spectrum here, the S3 signal looks a bit small because I am not in the good temperature to have a large signal, because I wanted in this experiment to see both the G4 and the S3, and it's difficult to have all at the same time. So on now the multi-line, the center which are still in the low spin configuration after the warming here does not progress to S3. But instead, we form S2 YZ dot state, which is characterized by a split signal. Shown here, the split signal is a YZ dot, which interacts magnetically with the cluster in the low spin configuration, and you have a signal. But as the spectrum is very narrow, and we have YD in the spectrum also, it's difficult to see. But maybe you can see here you have the split signal. So we demonstrate here that when we are when at pH 6.5, this is the oxidation of YZ at room temperature, which is proposed to trigger a deprotonation. We show here that increasing the pH mimic this electrostatic influence here. So we can go further. And if we do the same experiment now, but we put the sample at the pK value, for example, for you remember the pK value for okay, for calcium sample, sorry, it is 8.25. So we incubate the sample here at 8.25. And now we make a series of illumination, annealing in the dark, freezing a second illumination at low temperature, and so on. So first illumination, we form at 200K, we form the multi-line signal, low spin configuration. We warm the system in the dark. The multi-line signal disappeared, you form the high spin configuration. All does not disappear because we are at the pK value. So we can still have some multi-line here. So we make a second 200K illumination, the high spin state disappears, you form S3. Nothing here for the multi-line, you have a small speed signal here. Now you warm in the dark, and when you warm in the dark, the residual multi-line now convert into the high spin, and so on. So each time you saw the sample, the residual multi-line signal convert into the high spin configuration. If you do that four times, and you record the spectrum at the end, minus the baseline, you have this spectrum here, and you see the S3 signal. And if you make two flashes at room temperature instead of this complicated protocol, means that you go directly to S3 from S1, you have the same spectrum. So almost the same. So this is a way to produce S3 in a very high amount. and without to have a saturating flash laser, which is sometimes not easy when you have very, very concentrated sample. And so, and also it shows that you can progress into the estate cycle just by low temperature illumination. So the conclusion of this first part is that the low spin to high spin equilibrium is pH dependent. It's different depending if you have calcium or strontium. This implies, and this is demonstrated by the work of Ville, that the calcium-strontium exchange has a multiple effect on long distance effect, particularly on aspartate 61, W1, W2, and that is very important to explain the conversion low spin to high spin. The capability of the S2 high spin state to advance to S3 at low temperature, as low as 180 K, as I said, I think is an experimental demonstration that the low spin the configuration is going to S3 on via the S2 high spin configuration. I think there was no demonstration of that. It was just predicted by a calculation, but it's good sometimes to have experiment to demonstrate something. Something, it's a detail, but I think it's important. Long time ago, Stan-Björn Staring in the lab of Bill Rutherford demonstrated that the S2 to S3 transition was blocked at 230-240 K. I think it corresponds exactly to the temperature at which we have the low spin to high spin transition. So this block at 230 K of S2 to S3 is correspond to the block of the S2 low spin to S2 high spin transition. For the S2 high spin to S3, it works very well until 180 K. So on, as I said, we can make a very concentrated sample, or maybe for pistols, I don't know, could be useful to generate S3 by this way, I don't know. So we talk a lot about ammonia. So on what happens with ammonia? I will not come back on different interpretation. Here, I just put the scheme done by the group of Mila in which ammonia binds instead of W1. Okay, but so if the spectrum here, it's at what happens after illumination at pH 9.3 this time. I put very high pH value. If you anneal in the dark, what you see is the disappearance of the multiline. You see the G4, the high spin configuration, normal, as I showed before. But now, if you add ammonia, you lose completely the high spin configuration and you come back into the low spin configuration with, of course, a modified multiline signal here. So this demonstrates that the ammonia addition reverses the high pH effect, and we have the low spin configuration present whatever the pH value. In the experiment, there are two possible explanations. Either the ammonia binds to the high spin state, but it's less stable and come back to then the low spin and come back to the low spin state. Or we have an equilibrium, and I think this is probably a good explanation, between the high spin, low spin. Even if we have at high pH, we have maybe 1% or 0.1% of in low spin configuration, the ammonia binds into the low spin and of course shift completely the equilibrium in favor of the low spin configuration. Something we can discuss from the literature is a model proposed by Per Sigban for the exchange of water molecules. He proposed this scheme here between several states, starting from what is supposed to be the low spin configuration in S2. And he arrived in this one, in this state, which is the state in which the water can be done, water exchange can be done, mainly because you have a manganese free here. On which you can exchange the water molecule. And for me, it seems that it's very similar to the low spin configuration and this one to the high spin configuration. So could be a reason why Johannes saw, he disagreed with me, but it could be a reason why we have a fast exchange in high pH. And because probably we have an equilibrium between low spin, high spin, and when we increase the pH, we favor this state, and we know we you increase the exchange. We have to think that when we do the EPR, we just see the two steady the concentration of high spin and low spin but this is at the equilibrium. So, but when we do something like an exchange, water exchange experiment, the rate at which the water exchange depends on many things. The intrinsic rate, exchange rate in the two spin state, the concentration of the two state, and also at the rate at which the two state equilibrate. Of course, that is they are linked, but okay, they depend of all these parameters. So. So, and that could be for me an interpretation why it's very fast. The exchange is much faster and, at high pH because we favor this state here. So, we always with ammonia, we have several discussions today, and just I want to remember some important point. I think is that, but this was said this morning, that. With ammonia, there is no inhibition of oxygen evolution. So we have a period 4, which is completely normal. That is ammonia in condition where we modify the multiline, because as Holger said, we have other possibilities which could be inhibitory, but I don't use this condition. So this is only in condition where the multiline is modified in S2. So no change in the period 4 oscillation. When you look at the S0 multiline signal after three flashes, in the dark, this is the control, in the red with ammonia, there is no change in the hyperfine speed line in the multiline signal. So probably it means that in S0, ammonia is no longer bound. It is bound in S2, but in S0, it is no longer bound. When we look at the S3 to S0 transition after a flash, we have exactly the same kinetic as in normal sample, means that we have the like phase, which corresponds to the removal of a proton in S2 y z dot state. Here, it's 200, It's 200 microseconds, the time we have in the control sample. And the kinetic for the release of oxygen on S3 y z dot to S0 is 1 to 2 milliseconds, the normal value observed in elongatus. So there is no change at all. So it is very, I think it is very likely that S3, the ammonia is not bound in S3 YZ dot state. So finally, if you look at the S3 signal itself, it's not completely identical to the S3 signal. The normal, the S3 signal is in black, and with ammonia is in red. But the main feature here is exactly the same G value, and it's difficult for me to think that we can have a strong change in the geometry or something with ammonia, and to keep exactly the same signal here. So probably the small difference here is likely due to a kind of solvent effect with ammonia not very far from the cluster, maybe close to W1, but not instead of W1. And this means that for me, my feeling is that ammonia binds only in S2. And when you arrive in S3, you leave the site. Or when you do S2 YZ dot, it leaves the binding site. Why I say Y2 YZ dot? Because there is a very old result from Veltwist in 1975, and he found that the kinetics from S2 to S3, that is normally 400 microseconds in PS2 from Planck, was much lower down to 13 milliseconds with ammonia. And if you remember that ammonia inhibits the formation of the high spin configuration, you can imagine that finally this is the step which is slowed down here. This is in presence of ammonia, it's much more difficult to go to S3 because you cannot form the S2 high spin configuration, or at least if you form it, it comes back to S2 to the low spin configuration, and because the equilibrium is strongly favored for the low spin configuration. So, in the last minute, I would like to get one problem for people who are studying now the PS2 is to find a spectroscopic probe, in particular what happens with the water molecule. And, I think Hiroshi talked about that. It's very difficult to probe spectroscopically where are and how are the water molecules. This can be done by infrared spectroscopy. This was already done by a lot by the group of Noguchi, by the group of Debus. But as we are also interested in the spin conversion in S2, and that we can done by making infrared illumination, and that I don't want to talk about that here, but this is a way to have something we can study by infrared. But before to do that, we want to know what happens in S1 to S2. But to have new data, we want to study the very low, the far infrared region. Ono did that at the end of between 1990 and 2000, something like that. He already studied this region until 400 or something like that, for between S1 and S2. And now we can progress to very, very far infrared. That what is done with the group of Catherine Berthomieu and Rainer Innervadel in Marseille, and also with people from the synchrotron Soleil close to the COA Saclay. So we can now reproduce very well what Ono found in this spectral region, but we extend the detection until 100 web numbers. So it's promising. I will not describe too much what happened here because I am completely unable. But just I want to show you that because it I hope that very, very soon we can publish many data on just to see that this part is in progress. So just only one result. It's we, of course, for infrared, you make a water exchange with oxygen 18, with deuterated water, also with a mixture between H2O and D2O to have 50-50% to see if you have OH, OH2 or something like that. So important result, this bond at 602 web numbers, which was already shown a long time ago by Jerry Babcock on Warwick Hilly, I think. Rick Warwick was involved in the 602. Sure, yeah, you are right. So which was attributed to calcium water frequency. We think more that as it is weakly affected by calcium strontium, but not at all by water deuterium exchange. We think this is probably a manganese, oxygen manganese vibration mode. So it could be the mode which involves oxygen 5. It's promising for the model which involves oxygen 5 in water oxidation, but now it seems it's not oxygen 5, it's oxygen 4 and with manganese 7. I don't know, but we have so many models I cannot follow. So, okay, but I think we have good data, so very soon we can propose a better interpretation. So, thank you for your attention.
Well, thanks very much, Alan. Oh, we've got time for just a couple of quick questions. Yes.
Yes, it's nice. I like the cast specs very much. First question is this from spinach or cyanobacteria sample?
The EPR?
Yes.
All what I show today is from cyanobacteria.
So can you observe the similar signal at spinach?
It's a good point. I did not do it because I have no more BBY in the freezer. I don't want to redo BBY.
Okay.
Before I retire.
We can check this. I have another question.
No, but you are right. It should be done because.
Okay. Yeah. Sorry. I have another question because you talk about the PK, the proton release during S2 to S3 step.
Yeah.
But from Hogger, the PK actually they report they demonstrate the PK between for the S2 to S3 something like around 4.5 something like that. So why in your case it's quite high?
It's different because here we focus on one step, and you see that lot. This is what Holger is saying. It's at room temperature, so it's and at room temperature. I have no inhibition with the pH. You see, you progress because why is it not make the work? This is you see here. This is because I use the transition low spin high spin in the dark. So in the dark, you have no YZ dot on what is proposed in by Mülheim, and also by the Italian group for Guidoni, that this is YZ dot which induces a deprotonation. But in the dark, you have no YZ dot. This is why I use the pH. But I think both are similar. But when you have YZ dot, it's so strong that you remove the proton even at your pH.
Okay, any final question? Okay, well, I'd like to thank Alain again.